Welcome, Dr. Mary Hahn. Dr. Hahn is, of course, the Emil Holman Chair and Professor of Surgery at Stanford University in California. Welcome, Dr. Hahn.
Great, Dr. Wexner, thanks so much for having me.
Thanks for being with us and sharing your insights. And the reason I asked to interview you today is the remarkable success that Stanford has in ramping up services, and so much so that attracted the attention of the lay press in the Bay Area. Perhaps before we get to the ramp up, you could explain a little bit about what you did when you expected a surge at your hospitals.
Right. So Santa Clara County, which is where Stanford is, was one of the first places in the country to have a COVID positive patient. And we were under specific orders from the California Department of Public Health, as well as our county, to cease selective surgery quite early on before, and to have a shelter in place about a week before the state, we went to a statewide shelter in place. So we pivoted quite quickly to ramping down our elective cases to prepare for what we anticipated would be a huge surge in COVID positive patients. And I think between the early and aggressive shelter in place, the geography of the Bay Area, where we don't rely so much on public transportation, we don't have a lot of high-rise housing and other things, we never saw the surge. And in fact, at Stanford, I think the peak number of inpatients we had was 23 or 24. And our peak ICU numbers of patients were about 10 or 11. So we had all these surge teams prepared, ready to how we'd ramp up our ICUs, how we would open new wards, because we just opened a new hospital and had shut down a couple of old wards preparing for the surge. And then I think in mid-April, a couple weeks after the anticipated surge when we didn't see it, then we pivoted and put together a committee to look at how we would ramp back up procedures across Stanford Medicine. And, you know, we had always all along have been doing tier three procedures, maybe even some highly symptomatic tier two procedures, depending upon the urgency of the operation. But how we would bring back more of those tier two procedures as designated by CMS, as well as the tier one procedures. So we put a committee together of stakeholders, surgeons, anesthesiologists, operations folks, and said, what would it take? And what would our principles be? Another great advantage that we had is we had developed our own tests for COVID. We were one of the first FDA approved tests, and we have been able to get the supplies and to ramp up our capacity to do about 2,000 to 2,500 tests per day at Stanford. And we were seeing less demand from other external sources, other hospitals and clinics for those that testing capability. So the first thing we did over the course of 2 weeks is we ramped up occupational health and testing of our healthcare workers. And I believe we tested probably over 12 or 13,000 patient-facing healthcare workers across Stanford Medicine. And we did that in preparation for then wanting to ramp back up elective surgical procedures that we could, you know, show to our patients and our fellow healthcare workers that it was indeed a very safe place, that we didn't see much spread of any of COVID among the healthcare workers, and that the overall, that 99.7% of healthcare workers at Stanford were COVID-free. So these are asymptomatic people that we swabbed and found very little evidence of COVID. And that just would also reflect that there was very little COVID at this time in our community.
Just to put in context the 23 patients you had, how many hospitals are in your system and how many beds in those hospitals? Just curious what kind of percent that might represent.
Right. So we have 20, or we have three hospitals. So the 23 patients was in our adult hospital, and we have about 610 licensed beds. And then at Packard, our children's hospital, I don't think we ever got over a census of four COVID patients at the children's hospital and a license maybe of 300 and some beds. And then we, a third hospital that we have over in the East Bay, Stanford Valley Care, I think the max number of patients they have there were five, and they probably have about 200 or so licensed beds. So we never had an issue of being, you know, overwhelmed in any capacity. In fact, what we had was a paucity of patients in our emergency room as well as in our hospitals.
So now that you're bringing back in urgent surgery, now you're bringing back in non-urgent surgery and standard elective surgery, what kind of backlog do you have to deal with? And I know you mentioned you have a committee with the various interested parties, vested parties of anesthesia, surgery administration, and the like. How are you deciding amongst patients who need a bariatric operation versus a hip replacement versus vascular surgery?
Right. So when we initially put our committee together, we had a plan for test our healthcare workers by May 3rd, May 4th, begin doing all tier two surgeries with testing every patient for COVID as well. And then set May 18th to be able to do any surgical patient. And assuming that we had the testing capabilities. So we had guardrails around, you know, we were gonna watch occupational health, we were gonna watch how frequently patients tested positive. And two things happened. One, I think the very low rate of COVID among our healthcare workers. And number two, our governor basically said the first part of the shelter in place that he was lifting was for healthcare facilities to resume what he called essential surgery, but included basically anything in there with the exception of cosmetic surgery. So screening colonoscopy was in there and surgery for the treatment of diabetes. So at that point we pivoted and we just said starting May 4th, we will put any surgeon's case on the schedule. And knowing that it would take a while for us to ramp up through that backlog, we had plenty of capability to do surgical procedures across the system that we ended up not using a tiering system. And two reasons we didn't. One, as we started reaching out to patients, there were many patients who, even though they would have, may have fallen into that tier two, they weren't ready to come for surgery. They wanted to delay their surgery. So as far as I know, even last week, our first week that we just opened it up for everybody, we were only at about 2/3 of our normal surgical volume. And this week, we think maybe we'll get to about 75% of our normal surgical volume. And we still have a shelter in place. So I think that is making many of our patients reluctant to come forward. It's making discharge planning a little more challenging if they live alone or they were counting on a family member traveling in from another region, that because of all the travel restrictions, that's making some of that post-discharge planning challenging.
How often will you be testing the employees? That's a huge number that got tested, but of course people then go home to their families and these days may even see a few friends here or there in limited numbers with appropriate physical distancing, but it does beg the question as to the frequency of testing.
Right, so right now we are not planning to continue to test asymptomatic healthcare workers. We're obviously testing anybody who's symptomatic, anybody who's had an exposure and has a concern, you know, about becoming positive. And we're testing anybody who has tested positive, we're continue to test them until they turn negative. So that's how we're managing our healthcare workers at this point. And then, you know, at the guidance or direction of our county health department, if they want us to do a random sample of testing of healthcare workers, then we would work with them on that. An interesting thing came up because the CDC hasn't mandated COVID testing like they do for flu immunization and TB testing. We couldn't mandate COVID testing among our healthcare workers, but we were a large majority of the healthcare workers came forward to get tested.
I seem to recall that I think the percentage was 85% of patients were willing to come in. That I came across a figure somewhere, which seems higher than elsewhere in the country, and perhaps it's in part due to the fact that they feel very secure in the environment. But did you have any issues with patients because they were now unemployed and didn't have insurance where it was time to come in for surgery, but they didn't have coverage? This is something we've heard about nationally as certainly being a concern.
Right. So I not that I'm aware of that has been a reason for a patient not to proceed with surgery at this point. We definitely had the similar challenge of unemployment in California as the rest of the nation is seeking. And what I don't know is if they're still maybe perhaps under COBRA if any benefits got extended with some of those layoffs. But that is, so just like clinical urgency, we're really trying to listen to our patients if they're concerned about losing their healthcare coverage and we're getting geared up to undergo a surgical procedure, that would be another reason to prioritize.
You have a lot of people that report to you, obviously, as chair and professor of surgery. There are some other groups of people who are impacted in different ways. Residents and fellows, for example, were not working the same during the 2 months as they otherwise would be, and medical students. So where do you stand now, and today's May 11th, where do you stand with student education, resident education, fellow education?
We have resumed a lot of resident conferences by Zoom. While we were preparing for the surge and really focusing on PPE conservation, we had really restricted the number of trainees in the operating room. And now we definitely are inviting the residents back into the operating room. However, we're still restricting the number that scrub into a case. We have plenty of surgical masks at this point, but we still have a shortage of gowns. We were affected by the cardinal gown issue, and I think the supply chain is still pretty tight on surgical gowns. So we're limiting the number of people who scrub in, trying to limit the number of breaks that the scrub techs take. And who actually uses the surgical gowns. Our medical students are going to come back the end of May. They're going to be tested before they come back into the clinical environment, especially they've been scattered all across the country. So about half are going to come back in the end of May, and we'll have a full complement of medical students the end of June. They will not be involved in the care of COVID patients, although we have so few. And then they will be invited to come into the operating room, but we will probably ask them to not scrub unless we actually need their assistance with the case until we feel that we have more confidence in our gown supply.
Thank you. And the other part of what changed, the Zoom conferences, which will go on, and medical student education, you'll still have video conferences, I'm sure. What about the telehealth aspect for patients? I'm sure, like everyone else, you quickly ramped up the provision of video visits to patients. And what's your plan for that type of interaction with patients going forward?
Yeah, we all, we had this plan to really ramp up our video visits, and nothing like a crisis to have that plan enacted. So I think we're really waiting to see what the government and the third party payers do. That was some of the bottleneck for ramping up of who we could actually see in a video visit and bill for. So we're, I think, planning to continue to really use video visits as part of our surgical practice. It's worked out well. We do it the same way we did when we saw patients in person. The resident will kind of go in and meet the patient first and gather some of the history and present to the attending, and the attending then visits with the patient. And we found that there is a lot of patients were pretty comfortable managing over video and even up to the point of surgery and meeting them just the morning of surgery. So we hope to be able to continue to really use that as part of our practice going forward. So our committee, as we were looking toward ramping back up, we set up, I talked about some guardrails of, testing healthcare workers, testing patients, monitoring occupational health, making sure we didn't see outbreaks, looking at the prevalence in the community. And we had written up all those guidelines and guardrails, and lo and behold, the American College of Surgeons comes out with exactly what we were planning as a safe way to start bringing back surgical care. So I want to thank the college really and their leadership for getting that out there as a guide for all of us.
Thank you very much for all of your insights. It's impressive the number of employees that you've tested, the way you're testing medical students, and the messaging you've given your patients, and certainly some of the educational challenges and patient communication challenges that you've met very well. So I thank you for your time. I wish you sustained health and look forward to seeing you in person at some point rather than on a video screen.
Great. Thank you. And thanks for doing this and allowing us to share our story.